On this week's show, Jaguar returns to single-seat racing with a Formula E entry, Nissan hints what charging your car in the future will be like, and Toyota finds it's hard to drive hydrogen cars if there are no hydrogen fueling stations around. These stories and more coming up next on 10. Enjoying today's show on YouTube and want to read the stories we're referring to today? Just head to our website at transportevolve.com/TEN, where you'll find today's show notes, as well as links to the latest future car news, buying guides, tech primers, and car reviews. It's Friday, December 18th, 2015. I'm Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield, and here's the final regular 10 show until next year, because, well, it's Christmas next week, and I'm pretty sure that you don't want a show that day. Getting on with the news of the week, we start today's show with a massive milestone for the CHAdeMO Association, the official body charged with maintaining and promoting the CHAdeMO DC Quick Charge Standard. As we reported on Wednesday, the CHAdeMO Association has announced that there are now more than 10,000 CHAdeMO compliant DC quick charging stations around the world, more than double the number that there were this time last year. The actual figure is 10,156, at least it was as of midweek, and the association says more than one half of all electric cars in the world today use the standard to quickly replenish their battery packs. So well done to the CHAdeMO Association and all of those who've helped make long distance trips more pleasurable for electric car owners. Of course, CHAdeMO isn't just a standard for getting power into an electric car battery. It can also be used to pull power out of an electric vehicle's battery pack, making it possible to use an electric vehicle or a hydrogen fuel cell car as a backup power supply in the event of a disaster. And this week, that's just what was going on in Japan, when the International Research Institute of Disaster Science, or IRIDES for short, held a mock earthquake disaster drill to see how electric cars, like the Nissan E-NV200 minivan, could be used to provide emergency power to a disaster command center. This time, the team actually used a low-powered 100-volt inverter rather than a CHAdeMO vehicle-to-home system to pull power from two all-electric minivans. But despite the low-tech solution, the drill was hailed an absolute success. What's more, it demonstrated how any of us could do the same thing with a plug-in car, given the proper equipment, of course. So next time the power goes out, remember your electric car could help you out. From using electric cars as backup power supplies to entertainment now, with the news from British automaker Jaguar Land Rover this week that it intends to enter the world of single-seat motorsport for the first time since 2004, with an official team entry for the third annual all-electric FIA Formula E race series. Jaguar, which left Formula One back when it was still owned by Ford, announced its triumphant return with a suitably electrifying video, the release of its official race design for the 2016-2017 season, and the promise that its time on the racetrack will help bring all-electric models to market. We're particular fans of this Tron-esque video, which not only pleases our inner geeks, but also does a pretty good job of electrifying Formula E for those who may not have seen it before. Of course, we'll find out more about the drivers that will join the team in the coming months, so as soon as we know who will be racing for the big cats, we'll let you know. Talking about the UK, we also brought you the news at the start of the week, which might make those of you who like their plug-ins with all-wheel drive a little happier. That's because on Monday, Mitsubishi announced a new trim level for the 2016 Mitsubishi Outlander plug-in hybrid. The new trim, GX5HS, sits above the existing GX5H trim level and pushes the five-seat midsize crossover plug-in hybrid a little closer to the luxury end of the market. Alongside full leather interior, all-round camera and heated seats front and rear, the new trim level brings in lane departure warning and a host of other advanced safety features, designed to make the Outlander PHEV cross-shop a little better against cars like the Volvo XC90 T8 and upcoming Audi Q7 plug-in hybrid. We're not sure if the improved trim, both at the GX5H and GX5HS levels, will make a huge difference, but from $43,399 for the GX5H and $45,499 for the GX5HS, neither model does come cheap. And add in the news from the UK government's plug-in car incentive programme from this week, and you might think twice about splashing out on that Mitsubishi. That's because on Thursday, the UK government unveiled the final details of its new tiered electric vehicle incentive programme. The programme, due to begin in February and run until at least 2018, is something we've talked about on the show before, but this is the first time we've had full details. As we explained on Thursday, the UK government's new £400 million commitment to plug-in cars comes with a catch. You'll no longer get a £5,000 flat grant for buying a plug-in car. Instead, if your car costs under 60 grand and does more than 70 miles in zero emission mode, you'll get £4,500 towards the cost of your car. If it does less than 70 miles in zero emission mode, you'll only get £2,500. And if your car costs more than 60,000 quid, you won't get a penny, presumably because the government is worried about the political backlash of helping people buy Tesla Model S sedans. Interestingly, though, the base Model S 70D will still be eligible, as its list price is £56,200 before incentives. So if you want to plug in, that might be the car for you. It's also worth noting that the changes also halve the amount of money that you can get to help install a charging station for your car. So if you want to do that, best do it before February. From one set of regulatory changes to another now, but this time in California, where the California DMV has published a set of proposed rules governing the use of autonomous vehicles on the state's roads. We'll not get into every detail here, but it boils down to four very important facts. Firstly, the California DMV wants to ban all driverless cars requiring autonomous vehicles to have someone behind the wheel at all times who is both a fully licensed driver with a special autonomous vehicle endorsement on their license. This, aside from precluding autonomous Johnny Cab-style taxi services, also makes it impossible for anyone who cannot physically drive a car from owning and operating an autonomous vehicle, something we, and Google we note, are not that happy about. Other proposed regulations include giving automakers trial permits for 3 years so that autonomous vehicles have to prove themselves roadworthy before more concrete regulations are made, as well as a heap of requirements concerning cybersecurity and vehicle testing. It's a tad depressing if you've been waiting for the dawn of autonomous cars, but hey, we'll hope that the DMV in California sees sense before those proposed regulations become law. From one future vision to another, we head to Europe this week, where Nissan teased a new video hinting at how we could one day charge our cars. As we explained on Thursday, the short 20-second video alludes to the impending production of a new 7-kilowatt wireless inductive charging system that Nissan has been testing in its laboratories for the past few years. In the press release accompanying the video, Nissan promises that the technology will be perfect for wirelessly charging the 60-kilowatt-hour longer-range battery pack it's also preparing for production sometime in the next few years. We're yet to be convinced wholeheartedly of the benefits of wireless charging, but this video does the best job yet of making us want it on our car, because it just shows someone pulling up at a curbside parking space and the car auto-magically charging. Science rocks. Continuing that futuristic theme, South Korean automaker Kia and its sister company Hyundai were celebrating their own futuristic piece of news this week after being granted autonomous vehicle license plates for the US state of Nevada. The plates will go on some prototype autonomous Kia Soul EVs being sent to the region, as well as the world's first hydrogen fuel cell autonomous vehicle in the form of a prototype self-driving Hyundai Tucson FCV. As you can see from Kia's footage, Kia has already got its cars performing the usual autonomous driving maneuvers on its test tracks, so too has Hyundai, and its graduation into the real world of Nevada should help them prepare its autonomous drive technology for launch sometime in the next 10 years or so. That is, of course, assuming that California's new approach to autonomous vehicles doesn't spread over the border, putting a halt to the great autonomous vehicle research being done on all across Nevada, because that could really screw everyone's plans up. Which brings us to our final story, one in which the plans are so screwed up that poor old Japanese automaker Toyota has found itself having to step in. You see, as we reported at the start of the week, Toyota had hoped that the state of California would have plenty of hydrogen fuel filling stations operational by the time it launched its first production hydrogen fuel cell car, the 2016 Toyota Mirai hydrogen fuel cell sedan, back in October. But with only 4 Mirai-compatible fueling stations across the state operational, Toyota has now taken matters into its own hands, sending temporary hydrogen fueling trailers to 6 out of the 8 dealerships where the Mirai is sold. Sadly, however, they're not a great substitute for a real filling station. They can't operate at the high pressure required to give customers cars more than half full. have to be operated by dealership mechanics and must be trailered back to Southern California every few days or weeks for a refill. The result? Toyota Mirai customers can only drive around 150 miles between fill-ups, have to visit their dealer during work hours for refuel, and we'd guess have more range anxiety than your average newbie electric car owner. And that's most definitely not the way that Toyota wanted its revolutionary hydrogen fuel cell technology to launch. Whoops. Talking of things going whoops, we completely forgot until about half an hour ago that this is the last regular show of the year. So if you've been watching this year, we are very grateful for your company. We are going to try and bash out some special shows over the holiday period, after which we're off to CES and then to a very top secret location for some testing. So we're hoping to be back with you just as soon as we can in the new year. In the meantime, you'll find all the news that's fit to print on our website at transportevolve.com. You can catch up with us on Twitter at transportevolve or check out our latest shows on our usual YouTube channel. And if you liked what you saw today, please consider keeping us independent and impartial by visiting our Patreon page at patreon.com/transportevolve and pledging your support from as little as $1 per month. You know, if everyone who watched this video made that pledge, it'd fund some great new shows and it would also allow us to expand our staff too. So go on, help us out. As always, there's a lot we haven't managed to fit into today's show, including news of the Hyperloop pod building competition in Texas at the end of January, how Nissan is likely to launch a range extended electric car next year, news of another Chinese-backed automaker wanting to steal Tesla's electric car crown, and we give you an update on our long-term Hakkapeliitta R2 winter tyres. So when we're done, be sure to head to our site to read them all. Thanks for watching. I'm Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield. Have a great weekend. Have a great Christmas. And until next time, keep evolving.